Hi all. In this video, let's discuss about the ways to debug the JavaScript code. In the earlier video, I have discussed about the step-by-step procedure, how to debug a JavaScript code. I will keep that video in the end card. So let's discuss what all the ways to debug the JavaScript code. So most of the time we will be spending on how to fix the problems. So to do that, we need to find the issues and the root cause as good as faster. So these are some of the ways to debug the JavaScript code. So before that, I want to explain you one point. So sometimes when you're trying to debug some code, you'll be ending up in a few files. Which files? Those files are not relevant to your code. Like those files may be Google Chrome extensions or third-party libraries or frameworks. So sometimes while you're seriously debugging your code, you may reach to their code, like third-party code, and there is no necessary for us to go there. And again, there will be a number of iterations in their code and you will be coming back to your code. So you will be having an option. If you do that option, you will ignore the code of the third-party library code or Google Chrome extensions code, you'll be ignoring those parts. So let me show you that part before starting the debugging things. So for that, go here, the developer tools. So let me come from the first. So this is the application part. So inspect, you'll be getting the developer tool. And here, settings, gear icon. Here you'll be having an ignore list. So usually we'll be calling this as black box scripts. So check this and you can give the patterns. You can say this as node modules. So now if you give the node modules, all the files which are inside the node modules, the browser will not stop. It will not go through these node modules. So you can also give this any of the pattern, regular expression. So you can also give an Angular. So Angular min.js file, you will not be going to that. Rx.js files. So like that you can give, or also you can give any of the expression like min.js so that all the production files you'll be not going. So this is about the black box scripts. To avoid this, you can do this. So in this way, while you're debugging your code, you will not end up to the unrelated or not relevant code to your code. So this is how you need to ignore the things. Fine. So let me show you the six other ways how to debug. So let's start our video. The first way is console.log. So usually most of the time you will be using console.log. This is the first and the basic way of debugging the code. Most of the time you will be writing the console.log. So each and every log will be print in the console. In this way, you can debug the code, but it takes more time and you no need to log all the each and every line. You have a better option than this console.log, that is console.assert. So this is the first way and the easiest way. Like you'll be having two parameters for that. The first one is an expression and the second one is a message. Both these two parameters are required. The message will be string or an object. The expression will be evaluated to the Boolean. So let's see. Here we are calling a method. In this method, I'm trying to console. Here what I'm doing is just we have taken an array and we're trying to loop this array and we're trying to add all the elements in this array. So now what the console.assert I'm doing is I'm writing one expression. So if the sum is equal to 15, okay? So then if this fails, if this is true, then you will not get this console.assert. If this console fails, if this evaluates to false, then only you will be getting this console. Whatever the message you print, that will be printed. So in this way, you can write your logic such that you'll be expecting something. So you can keep that. If that fails, then only you log the things. Like you can log the object, respective object, or respective function. So let's see that. If now all these elements, if you add, that will come into 15 as a sum. So as 15 is equal to 15, you will not get this assert statement. So let's see that once. In the console, I'm going here. So now you'll be not seeing that assert because these are other errors related to the browser. So you will not see this error because this expression is evaluated to true. It means what you have expected is true. Then you no need to log the console. So let's do this. So I'm expecting the sum to be 10, but here the sum value is 15. Means the expression which you are expecting is not equal to the expected value. So then only you can log this assert. Then you can log this console.assert. So now if you see, the assertion has failed. Here you got see. Something went wrong as per your code. So in this way, you can understand where exactly the issue is there. So your expectation of this function is something, but you got another value. In this way, you can debug the code, respect your code. Instead, so this is a better version when compared to the console.logs. Console.logs will print for each and every loop, and for each and every time it will be printing. So instead of that, it's better to go with console.assert. So this is the first way to debug the JavaScript code. The second way is you can use a debugger keyword. So this is a keyword. If you write this keyword, the control stops. The browser will stop the execution at this function. It will stop at this function, and then you can step out. So you can go to each and every line. So here you have this option, step over. And it means you can examine each and every line, and you can check its scope, its local variables and global variables, and what all the breakpoints, what all the values in the each and every variable and iterations, everything you can do. So this is about the debug keyword. If you keep anything here, that the browser will stop the execution at this point. Remember one thing, if you keep the debugger keyword, the execution is stopped here. If you're not having these developer tools, now the execution will not stop. So what I mean to say is, if you're trying to debug in any of the ways, the developer tools is mandatory. You need to have this developer tool, then only the debugger will stop that at that point of execution. So whenever you do a debugger keyword, then at that point, the execution will stop, and you can find each and every line, and you can find out the root cause of the bug. So be careful if you're writing the debugger keyword. It's our responsibility to remove this debugger keyword and then only push the code. If this debugger is existing and if you push the code to the production, you'll face some issues like the code will be stopped here. So if someone opens our code and if they see this debugger, the execution will stop at this point. So they will be seeing a screen like this, the end users. That is not a good experience. So before you do whatever the debug at the development mode, while you are pushing your code, it's better to remove this debugger keyword. So this is the second way. And coming to the third way, you can do the debugging in the browser level itself. So for example, if I want to check, if I want to know what is the loop inside iteration, so I can click here. So in the browser itself, you can just click here. It means you're keeping a breakpoint. Here you can see you have kept one breakpoint at the line 60. Okay, you have kept a breakpoint. So instead of writing the debugger keyword in the code and removing that, if you forget it, it would be an issue. So instead of doing that, you can directly debug the code in the browser by keeping a breakpoint like this. So it also gives the same thing. The function stops at that point, and now you can examine each and every line. So what is going on each and every line, and you can try to understand the code. You can try to find the bug or the root cause of the issue. So this is another way. This is the breakpoint way. So in this way, you can understand where exactly the bug is there. So this is a breakpoint. So the another way is, in this breakpoint way, the code will stop, and each and every iteration, you need to understand what is going to happen. So this is a way of debugging the code, but it takes a bit time. If you know exactly what is the condition you are expecting and what is it is going to fail. So in that type of scenarios, instead of breakpoint, you can use conditional breakpoint. For example, if you right click on this 19th line, and you can do like this, you can add a conditional breakpoint. So you have keeping a conditional breakpoint at the line 19. So now what I'm doing is, I'm doing sum is double equal to 10. So this is evaluated to false. If sum is 15, here in our case, the sum is 15. It means we are trying to understand if the sum is 10, then it will not stop. We are keeping a conditional statement, like if the sum is 15. So if this expression is true, then only this breakpoint will be triggered. If not, it will not trigger. If this is true, then only it will trigger. Let's see this. So I will refresh this. Now, if you understand, it has stopped at this point because the conditional breakpoint, what I kept is the sum, if the sum is equal to 15, then only stop at this execution point. So that is what I have kept here. So that's the reason the control has stopped here, because I'm trying to examine the sum as 15. So that's the reason I'm getting it at the 15th point. So now if I I am trying to edit this conditional breakpoint, and I will keep this as 10. Now, the control will not stop at this execution. So again, if I refresh, it will not stop at this breakpoint because the condition is not true. So in this case, this is a conditional breakpoint way. Means if you're expecting some value to be true, so you feel that one variable or that some value is giving some not necessary value or not expected value, in that case, you can keep this conditional breakpoint. If that value is what you are expecting and what that is giving, if that is synced up, in that point only, you are keeping the breakpoint. This is known as a conditional breakpoint way. So let me remove this breakpoint for now. So, and coming to the fifth way. So the fifth way is, so if you have a code and in that, and you know the method name. So I know the method name as add. In the production codes, you can't exactly have this code. You can't identify, you can't keep the debuggers like this. You can't keep the, because the code will be in minified way. So you can't examine exactly where the function is because every function will be bundled in a single file. So you can't examine where the exactly the code is. In these situations, you can use a debug function like this. And you, if you know the function name, just do like this, debug add. Now, debug add and method. So if I click this, you will be stopping at that function. In this way, you can debug the code even if the function or is present in a bundled file or a minified file or in a production code. If you just know the function name, just use this debug add. First, you need to refer it. Just keep add and then you do add off function. Now you're calling that function. In this case, the function control will stop at the beginning of that function. This option is very much useful if you want to debug something in the production or in a situation where you can't find your function, but you know the function name, then you can invoke it directly like this. So here no one is calling this add function. So whereas coming to this sum of number, so I'm calling this sum of number here. So that's the reason our control stopped here many times, but in terms of add here, no one is calling this add function. Only the method name you know, and you're trying to call that and you're trying to debug that method. So if you want to pass any of the parameters, you can pass here. So this is the fifth way. So coming to the sixth way, this is also similar to the debug way, but the method is different. You can do this with the monitor. So let me remove this debug first. So now in this way, here also you need to refer the method first. Thereafter, you need to call that method with the braces. So now in this method also, it will halt or it will stop the execution. It will call this function and it will be stopped at this point. Now, if you can examine or you can debug, you can see what is exactly the root cause. And this is the sixth way of debugging the code. If you see, it has returned the values. You can just call the function, what is happening in that function, and you can provide the respective parameters and that function would be executed. So that you can feel what exactly is happening in the production code or in the minified code. So these are the six ways of how to debug the JavaScript code. I have done a special video on how to debug the JavaScript code step by step. I will keep that at the end card. So if possible, try to watch that video as well. So thanks for watching. Please subscribe for more videos.